All right, here we go. This is a very special episode of the Regular Awesome Podcast. We are venturing out past our core crew of Washington University alumni friends and talking with someone who was not at WashU, but I think a very big inspiration to a lot of us musically, and who has been referenced in several of the podcasts thus far, the great Marc Friedman of the Slip fame. And Surprise Me, Mr. Davis, and currently playing with Ryan Montbleu and making all sorts of awesome music for people's ears all over the world. It was particularly great for me to talk to Mark. I've been a huge fan of his playing since, I think, you know, 3 or 4 days of getting to college. One of the first shows I saw when I got to St. Louis in 1998 was The Slip at a club called Cicero's. And was immediately hooked on their music. And there's not a whole lot of bands that I did lots of irresponsible things to go see. And The Slip was one of those bands. And I'd do it again tomorrow if the opportunity arose. So we will be back next week or two, depending on when I get done, talking immigration law and policy with our good friend Emily. But today we're doing this dive, this music dive, into the world of Marc Friedman. We start off kind of talking the presence of musicians on social media, and then move into what Marc's doing currently with Ryan Montbleu and the music he's making for YouTube Creator Studios and a bunch of other cool stuff. Not too long thereafter, we do get deep into the world of The Slip, and Mark shares some really great stuff, and we reminisce, and it's awesome. I loved it, and I'm sure there's a whole bunch of Slip fans out there, and Bar Brother fans, and Surprise Me, Mr. Davis fans, and Ryan Montbleu fans who'll find this interesting or entertaining, and hopefully somewhat meaningful to hear Mark talk about a lot of this stuff. And not to give too much away, but I got to give a big thank you to Mark and to Clean Tones, Clinton, for helping me track down what myself and a handful of our friends believed was one of the greatest notes ever played by Mark or any human being on any instrument, and it happened about 17 years ago. And we've been searching to find a recording of it. And Mark and Clean Tones helped me track that down. And I was just sitting at work thinking, you know, I'm going to listen to all these recordings and you know, would I even remember it? Would I experience it the same way? And sure enough, I did. So we found the note. It's in there. You will get to hear it. And the special features on the website, you can actually listen to the whole tune and not just the flurry of notes that led up to the greatest note. So I hope you all enjoy that. One special bonus at the end is Mark sent one of his tunes that he has made for the YouTube Creator Studios called Walk the Line. That song appears in its entirety at the end of the podcast, so check that out, and then check out Mark's stuff on YouTube Creator Studios under the name Freedom Trail Studios, Freedom Trail Studios. So without any further ado, the great Marc Friedman.
Hello.
Hey.
Thanks about that.
Yeah.
Thanks for letting me do that.
Yeah, of course.
I just said something funny, and I didn't know if anyone's going to react.
Yeah.
But they didn't really react to my joke, so I was like, I'm out of this thread for now.
And then.
Important things to do.
It's not exactly where I want to start, but you do have a very entertaining like online presence, I will say. Like your fit gig thing.
Oh yeah.
And your little like graphics that you add to everything. I do appreciate that.
Oh, thanks. You know, I always think that the internet's a kind of a boring place, so it needs a little little spruce, like some sprucing up in the corners, you know.
For sure.
Put a flower in that corner, whatever, you know.
Exactly.
Well, yeah, I appreciate it. I think it's a kind of a funny paradigm, you know, to live in with the whole internet, you know, the internet avatar culture we're all living in. So,
yeah,
you know, I kind of, like everyone else, I'm sure, kind of love and hate it, you know.
Oh, yeah. Did you ever go through, like, things where you just, like, totally disconnect and you're like, I can't do this anymore? And then...
With social media?
Yeah. Or just even, your phone.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I started hearing about off the grid, like, maybe 10 years ago, and it's starting it makes a lot of sense. I do think, like, it benefits us to be of the older generation that, you know, had like tactile analog experiences, like when we were little. And I think we might know how to like handle these things pretty well. You know, it's basically just like a computer you hold all the time now.
Yep.
So I don't freak out about that much. I don't have a hard time like limiting my social media, like,
yeah, that's
time,
more what I'm getting at, like the psychological impact of it, not like the
I think it's you know, I don't think it's great, but it's definitely like a, like I said, like, you know, in our generation, at least we experimented with like the earlier forms,
mm-hmm.
like MySpace and Friendster. So we kind of got, you know, we definitely built into it slowly, so we kind of understand what it's all about.
Yeah.
Although it definitely can, it's definitely morphing now, and I'm not very interested in talking about politics on Facebook. It's just not that interesting to me because it's you're naturally kind of with your crew anyways.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I've actually turned Facebook into basically MySpace.
I
only use it to like follow music that I like, and then I've just basically unfollowed everybody else, or, you know, if I have a friendship with them outside of like the internet, then I just unfollow them so they don't know. And then if I don't know them, I just unfriend them.
Yeah.
Easier.
Yeah, I mean, it's the more you engage with it, the more time it takes out of your day, and that's when it gets a little intense.
Wonky.
You know, I kind of wish I didn't have to, you know, like you said, I kind of deal with it mostly just for creative stuff and music, and like I don't put family stuff up there really, or anything too opinionated. And even that though, I you know, I don't really want to do that because I know that the overall guise of Facebook is really not so much about self-promotion, it's about, you know, kind of individual voices being on a level playing field, you know. So it's not really a great promotional place, so I try to limit that for sure. Or like you said, I like to try to add things that maybe make it different but not try too hard, because there's also that element of, you know,
like,
so it's definitely
yourself.
I mean, it's funny though, because, you know, what, back 10, 15 years ago, you might join a band or get a gig and maybe the publicist would contact you, or they have a publicist and they're doing some work. But these days, a band leader might look at you and say, so what can you do for publicity after they've hired you?
Right.
And so there's a lot of pressure, some pressure, and a lot of interest in, you know, putting up information about your gigs up there. So,
right.
You know, you try to just keep a balance on, you know, on that front.
Yeah. So let's get into some of the music stuff.
Sure.
So, I mean, I want to talk a bit about like all the stuff that, you know, got me into your playing and all that stuff. But like recently, it seems like the, one of the gigs, at least I see that you're doing regularly, is the Ryan Montbleu thing. Is Ryan also like a Boston guy? How'd you hook up with that? What's that been like? What's your role in that band and all that good stuff?
Well, yeah, Ryan is from north of Boston, where I am from south of Boston.
Okay.
So we're, and he's from Peabody. Ryan and I were born on the same day.
Is that
of
true?
The same year. Yep.
Oh, wow.
June 18th, 1977.
Uh-huh. Soul Brothers.
Yeah, which we figured out on our first gig together ever, because it was an I started playing with him in 2012, 2013, or 2014, one of those years. And our first gig was in Costa Rica. And so he was like, hey, I need your birthday, you know, for the ticket.
Right.
And then it was like, bam, oh, no kidding. But yeah, you know, he's a cat that the Slip had done one, maybe two shows with the Ryan Montbleu band.
Uh-huh.
But I wasn't really, you know, I wasn't really too aware of the music, or we weren't exactly on the same scene.
Sure.
So I started hanging out with them in the later 2000s on maybe there was a jam cruise, and then there were some jazz fests and stuff in New Orleans where we were just kind of hanging out. And right. He was a big fan of the Slip.
Sure.
And so I was like, oh, this guy must be cool.
He's a smart man. Yeah. You knew he was wise.
He's got his ducks in a row.
That's right.
Jeez. So I was actually living in California, and I think I had just hung out with him, and I just sent him an email like, if you ever want to, you don't need a bass player. And so yada, yada, whatever. And so that was it. Started filling in a little bit. And his band had, he had a rather large band, maybe 7 or 8 pieces.
Oh, wow.
And at that point, they had kind of run their course a little bit, and he was moving on. He also does solo shows as a singer-songwriter.
Right.
And so at that point, I think he was looking for a smaller group, ensemble, you know, of some sort at that point anyways. So it was actually great timing. And he kind of like restructured the band at that point, and I've been with him for 4 or 5 years. Nice. Kind of helping him a little bit, or you know, being with him as we restructure and work for a sound. And it's been fun because it's just been kind of a journey, and we're still looking, and it's like a pretty organic, and that's fun, you know.
That's great.
And we never settled on a certain formula. A couple years ago, we were a larger band. We'd have some backup singers and some horn players.
Got the tools and a lack of recognition, just enough to keep you hungry, boy. Hungry for food, fantastic ambition. Fishing for ease, so to catch some noise. And if you go too slow, you never get it. If you go too fast, you never get to get it good.
You know, now we're going out as a four piece, you know, and it's great. There's a drummer named Tommy Deal in the band, and also Justin Mazur on like lead guitar.
Okay.
And this guy Sam Gilman plays keys, like when we're in the Boston area and around New England. And yeah, Ryan plays acoustic guitar and electric guitar very well, and he writes really incredible songs. And it's awesome. I mean, to jump from the Slip and surprise Mr. Davis, which is like a side project with Nathan Moore in the Slip, into Ryan, I'm one lucky bass player. You know?
That's awesome. Yeah, I've been listening a lot to the Ryan record that I was just leaving. I think it's like the most recent one. So do you like? I mean, we'll get into it in a minute, but I mean, from my perspective, like you're such a incredibly well developed like player, not just bass, but you know, just arranging and just the way you think about music and harmony and all that stuff, from what I remember, and at least what I've projected onto your playing. Do you get involved with Ryan and that stuff? Are you helping like arrange stuff and figure it out?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I haven't recorded with him yet because he hasn't done too much recording in the last couple years.
Mm-hmm.
We've been really, you know, he'll do some solo stuff, like for albums. He'll put out some live acoustic things, I think.
Right.
He'll do some singles, and he does like some Spotify single stuff with like other singers, and you know, he has a cover of
Fast Car,
which is really cool.
Yeah.
And his last album, it was just him, and that I Was Just Leaving record was just done with him and Anders Osborne.
Oh,
and
wow.
Anders was playing all the other instruments, and you know, I listened to it and I was like, man, this is exactly what I would have done. This is great.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. The record sounds great.
Or not exactly, but, you know, they wanted a simple arrangement, and it was just really cool. So yeah, I've embellished on that a little bit in the live setting. And, like I said, we're still developing. And now that we're in a more of a 4-piece thing, the effects and the shaker is definitely coming out more, you know, filling out more sound.
Sure.
The shaker's there. I don't know if you guys I don't know if the podcast remembers the shaker, but it's like a little metal thing I use to scrape the strings.
Oh, yeah, of course. It was like a diamond-shaped kind of thing with a handle, and you would you'd get sort of those long, like, drony notes out of it, maybe.
Yep,
exactly. Am I remembering that correctly?
You know, I mean, well, you know, it's kind of like, it's just a little weird thing.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, so the effect stuff, kind of the over-the-top, on-the-top production stuff is definitely happening.
Yeah.
I think the exciting thing is I think we're definitely gearing up to record a record together in the next year or so, you know, cool. Or do some tracks.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, yeah, it's funny, you know, recording, it definitely was more of a thing for me. And also I think a lot of people 10, 15 years ago,
yeah,
you know, it was definitely more of a thing, get in the studio every 2 years or so and, you know, kind of keep it,
sure,
keep the engine moving with a label, distribution, whatnot. It's definitely changed a little bit, you know, like with,
yeah,
in this day and age, like I said, the Spotify singles, like one-offs are really more conducive to,
sure,
like, you know, society's entertainment needs now. So,
yeah.
So, yeah, like I'm not surprised. It's the whole industry is kind of adapted and slowed down in the recording sense.
Yeah.
But also, you know, I have my own recording situation, you know, of my own with like a computer and all that analog gear.
Yeah.
Tons of gear. So the tools are definitely out there. And I've always been demoing stuff and doing little side projects here and there.
So what's some of the other stuff that you've been working on outside of the Ryan stuff?
Well, the cool thing is about a year ago, I got a call from a couple friends of mine who work over at YouTube and Google.
Okay. I've heard of them.
And they're like old Slip family. Some of them are managers and some cats are like people I've actually made some music with. But basically they have a thing for YouTube creators where they wanted to have an audio library of songs.
Sure. I've seen
where
it.
where people can, you know, use that music for their videos and not have copyright issues.
Right.
So since about a year ago, I've delivered about 30 tracks to them.
Oh, wow.
Under the name Freedom Trail Studio.
Oh, I'm going to check it out.
Yeah. And the best way to find that, I like to make people hunt for it, you know.
Okay.
back of the record store. You know?
Yeah, sure.
Weird box that says don't throw away, but
that's
don't
right.
open.
That's
but yeah, I mean, one way to do it is just go to youtube.com/freedomtrailstudio, you know, and then you'll go to my homepage and you'll see some of the stuff there. And to actually download it, you just kind of have to look through the YouTube creator kind of app and you'll find a place that says audio library.
Oh, wow.
And then you can go right there and download all the tracks for free.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
So is there any connection between the people at YouTube and Google doing that and the whole thing that happened, I guess, back in the day at this point with Even Rats ending up on Guitar Hero? Is it similar folks or those are just two different?
Those are different folks.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, it's funny. I think we just – Harmonix was just in touch with us recently about relicensing that for some of their
– yeah.
downloadable content.
Yeah.
I did a little work for them at one point too. I was kind of the liaison between some bands on within our genre and getting their tracks into like the downloadable store, not a hard disk. But there's a DLC, downloadable content element of Rock Band.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
So yeah, I was the kind of the go between Garage à Toi and Lettuce.
Oh, cool.
And Charlie Hunter, and they wow. all got like one song into the downloadable store.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, it was cool. Like I actually did some of the authoring too, which is like the MIDI notes. Like
oh,
I did.
Really?
Yeah, I did a little bit of that too, just because they needed some like extra help with their downloadable content. So.
Sure.
All right, yeah, so that was a fun thing I did about 10 years ago.
So if anyone's searching the downloadable content in Guitar Hero, all that really cool music is there because of Mark.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's some extra Slip tracks and Davis tracks, too.
Right.
There's, like, Sisyphus and stuff, you know.
Oh, yeah.
So, again, you know, back of the record store.
Yeah, exactly. That's funny.
But anyways, yeah, the Freedom Trail Studio stuff is really funny, too, because it's like I had to envision, well, what the heck are people going to want to hear? So you're definitely not going to hear, you know, you're not going to hear like the stuff that sounds like a magnum opus or I don't even know it. What I'm saying is it's not like exactly my music. I really wrote for what I thought kids would want to hear or rock, you know, pop fans.
Right.
And that could be a good challenge. Honestly, that's one of my favorite things to do anyways. So, yeah.
And it's probably a good challenge. Works out.
Yeah. It's kind of cool. Yeah. You know, I wrote a tune thinking of like, what would Beyonce do over this, you know, and just, it's, or like another one reminded me of Shakira for some reason, even though I've never heard of Shakira, but,
you just know, pictured her dancing and her hips moving. Yeah. And you said, okay, what music goes with this?
So, yeah. So there's some real rock and pop and Michael Jackson type sounding stuff. And then, the 10 tracks that just went in that'll be available soon are, I'm happy to say, are like way more jazz influenced and improvisational, because that's kind of an area they were looking to bulk up their catalog in. So that's been really cool too, because I was like, holy cow, I could you know, get back into some jazz composition here.
Nice.
It's great because I don't really want to put on a jazz record,
but
I'm ripping some bass solos on that stuff and everything.
Nice.
It's really cool.
So the good thing is it's royalty free, so if you want, let me know like one of those tracks, and I can feature it at the end of the podcast, like just play the track in its entirety.
Totally.
And that could be really cool and a good inspiration.
Absolutely.
For people to check out all your stuff.
For you, that's free, my friend.
Okay. I appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll send them all.
Okay,
but
cool.
But maybe I'll
pick out like
one
or two
that
or
I think would be good.
Yeah, cool.
Cool.
All right, so let's go back a little bit further. So if you're willing to hear,
absolutely.
You know, the reference, I don't know if you had a chance to listen to the Carl Toborowski episode of the podcast, but that is the one in which you are featured or in which you're mentioned. And the mention of you, I don't know if you remember the story, but our friend Carl and I were reminiscing that it was one of the years the Slip came through St. Louis, and I think you guys maybe slept at the house we were renting or something, and we had like our band practice stuff in the basement. And I remember like we were in the basement and you guys were just kind of noodling around. And I came down as, you know, I looked up to you guys a lot for your musicianship and stuff. And I remember I showed you that I had learned Donna Lee, and I was very proud of myself for learning Donna Lee. And I guess I was probably a junior that year, junior. And I think you immediately were like, oh, that's cool. And you just started like, you know, playing the changes on bass. And you kind of like were like, okay, so you learned it, you know, take a solo, which at that point there was no way I could work my way through a solo that would be even remotely respectful. So I just sort of like, you know, cowered, and I don't remember what I did, but that's one of the stories that we referenced about you, as well as driving lots of hours to see you guys play.
Well, I hope I was nice about it too.
You were very nice about it.
Oh,
you were,
good.
You were very nice. So with that in mind, I'd like to talk a little bit about, I mean, I don't know how much you want to talk about the Slip stuff, but,
Oh no, I mean, it's your podcast.
Yeah. the reason I think you guys, for me, and you're playing and everyone's playing, Brad and Andrew as well, was so, I think as a 17-year-old kid at the time, was so important, was I grew up in Miami in Kendall, which if you've ever been to Kendall, you know, good luck finding good live music to see ever. You know, if you don't have a car and you can't drive.
Mm-hmm.
So getting to St. Louis, where there were a whole bunch of clubs kind of in walking distance from the university, I think I went to a show, I think like 10 nights in a row when I got there. And those shows were, two of them were you guys. One night, I don't know if I'd heard of you guys. I don't know if I stumbled upon you, but it was at that club Cicero's.
And, oh, yeah.
Yeah, and so I went one night. I think you were opening for maybe the Jazz Mandolin Project, and then one night you were headlining. It was just your show. And I remember, like, I was there, and I remember the song it was Cumulus.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, I'm way into this band, like, already. And I remember, actually, after the gig, I went up to you, and, you know, because I was a 17-year-old, you know, shy, embarrassed kid, but knew I was inspired by these guys who played. I didn't really know.
And I was 21.
Right. I didn't know what to say, so I was like, I think I said something like, so you must like Jacko. And you kind of looked at me like, oh, you think, you know, I had nothing to say, but I just remember like I had to say, you know, I had to say something. I had to like show that like I was paying attention, you know, and I appreciated, you know, the music you guys were playing. But I remember like those tunes were, it was a type of songwriting. It was a type of playing like instantly it jumped out at me that like you were covering melody parts, you know, in yep. tunes, and the way you guys harmonize things and reharmonize things in the middle of tunes. It was really like, you know, it was a ear opening thing what you guys were doing, at least for me at that time, and it carried over. I mean, I got way into your music, so I'm just curious, you know, did you recognize at that time that like the way you wrote was different than kind of other people in the scene were doing it, and like was that a concerted effort? What was like sort of, you know, what's your background in that? How did it develop? You know, share some insight on the early Slip days and the songwriting process and your playing style and all that good stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, I think we did a little bit. We all met in high school. Mm-hmm. Andrew and I were 14 and Brad was 16.
Right.
And so, and I had already seen Brad play when I was in seventh or eighth grade, I think, because my brother went to the same high school.
Okay.
So that's, I mean, that's kind of where it starts. I mean, we had been already working on the stuff for, you know, we had a head start basically 3 to 4 years of high school.
Right.
Where we were all under this cat named Mr. Sanborn. Okay. He was like our music teacher, you know? So we were like in the jazz band together, you know, and we were like, they were showing me this stuff they were listening to, Andrew and Brad. And it was, you know, it was more like, more the neo-hippie stuff, you know, like Fish and Zappa. Right.
Sure.
And stuff like that. And I was like, you know, maybe I should not bring my Poison tape to the table right now. I'm just going to leave that at home.
Right.
You know, not even going to mention Poison right now. But, you know, I was kind of getting out of my Poison phase and figuring out like Nirvana and some of that stuff. And so, you know, right away it was like Influence City. Like, what do you have? What, you know, what do you got? Those guys were definitely kind of a couple steps ahead. They're from an urban area like Providence.
Right.
And so they were kind of like, I was like, oh, these guys are some wicked tastemakers, you know? So it was cool, you know? So that's kind of like, that's where it started. I was like, oh, this is cool. This is some new music. And we just started to learn a bunch of stuff and bring each other different stuff, music that we're into, you know?
Yeah.
Whether it was Jocko, Weather Report, the Crusaders, you know, Miles Davis, Coltrane, Cannonball, everything. And obviously it was, because it was jazz band and stuff like that, it kind of stayed there, you know, like we stayed in that improvisational, you know, going for it type, you know, style of music. There was also like Paul Simon and other Little Feet, you know,
sure,
bands like that we were really into too. And so, and contemporary stuff, you know, maybe not even so much. It was just, it was a lot of like looking back at what there was and improvisational music, Pat Metheny.
Right.
And at the time, you know, Colonel Bruce Hampton came up a bunch. We were definitely listened to their music and
Aquarium Rescue Unit and stuff.
Yeah. And Fish was definitely, you know, a big influence at that time. Lawn Boy was out. Picture of Nectar had just came out.
Right.
So those are some of our early influences, you know. And then we went to Berklee School of Music for about a year or so. And I think like in the basement at that time, like in the basement of the house where we were living, that's kind of how we developed. We'd already been playing as a trio for a half a year or a year and doing gigs and stuff. We were doing gigs in high school at this local club called The Living Room in Providence.
Right, sure. Yep.
But I think in that basement, like in Boston, is where we really got into the trio songwriting. And it was kind of based on Paul Simon and Metheny. And that kind of thing, like energy playing off each other, and there's just a whole lot of ears, you know.
Right.
Like I had been supporting Brad's solos or whatnot, you know, for years, so I kind of knew where things were headed.
Sure.
You know, and that's really important. Like the time is really, again, one of the main things is the time we spent together already. And knowing and appreciating each other's like stylings.
Right.
And I'm a little bit of a guitar player too. And
yep.
Brad's a key, you know, like a piano player. So there was really kind of a global like thing going on. Andrew's pretty, you know, diverse too, like with hand drums and marimbas and all kinds of instruments. With so there was really a bunch of people there, you know, not just the three of us,
right?
You know, conceptually. So
and you also played piano as well, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
So, you kind of brought
I think that's what you were hearing at that time was like a lot of appreciation and confidence in each other. And Brad was working out the vocals, and I always was a fan of his singing and like
I love it.
Kind of a Donald Fagen approach or
for
whatnot.
Sure. Yeah.
And that's what it was. And I think we definitely had some peers, you know, bands like Schleho and
Lettuce Orchestra.
At that time and Miracle Orchestra.
Yeah.
But you know, also just based on the instrumentation being a real lean trio.
Right.
I mean, that kind of set us up in a different world, you know, right away, you know?
Yeah. You guys had an approach, though, I think. Like, I went to see, you know, all those bands that you just mentioned. And there was definitely, like, a style that... It's not that all the other bands sounded alike. They didn't. You know, Schleho had their sound. And, you know, at the time, like, Soul Live, you know, was picking up around then. And everyone kind of had their sound, and it was distinct. But you kind of, like... For me, at least, like, I kind of got it. Like, I was, all right, this is what they're doing. Like, you guys, I couldn't put my finger on what you were doing.
I'd say the one thing we did do, which, again, lent itself, the trio is, it's no small thing. Like, it's no small
it's hard.
Key factor
in
what we did. Because the ability for a trio to fill in space and make it bigger, but also make it move in directions, was so, like, built in to our regiment. And what we were doing... which is maybe what you're thinking about, was we were definitely improv songwriting a little bit too up there.
Right.
Like, it wasn't just an improv solo.
For sure.
It was like Brad knew when to look at me and say, or, you know, there'd be moments where I could just start building chord changes.
Right.
And Andrew would take it into a completely different, you know, rhythmic zone. And Brad would find that harmony even before I got there,
right.
You know?
And but there's definitely a
and
level
that,
of
that
like,
kind of thing. I do agree. It was like, I remember the first time we ever did that, like in 1995 or 96. And I was like, this band is going to be really fun, you know?
Yeah.
And I remember saying to Brad before this gig at Brown University, why don't we do these chords? And they're just the chords of like the bass strings going down, G, D, A, E.
Right.
But G major, D major, A minor, E minor.
Sure.
And it just felt really good to just play off those chords for the first song. And then we took it to a different part together on our own, you know?
Right.
Like, that's when I was like, man, this is really fun.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, for sure.
And I think that's what you're talking about. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so for sure. I mean, I have all these like kind of little memories. I mean, you know, I remember like, and this could be just like a false memory, just combining things. But I remember a gig, you guys at High Sierra, 1 year that I made it out there, and I think it was like the beginning of Sometimes True to Nothing or something, and just the voicings you chose to put behind kind of that pentatonic thing at the beginning, you know, just were different than I'd ever heard it before, and it had this emotional context to it, you know, where just like if you knew that song, if you had a, you know, history of listening to that song, and then you heard the voicings you were choosing or the harmonies you were choosing to open at that time, it reoriented it for me. And I was like, these guys are, you know, insane. Like, and it probably was what you're just saying. It was probably just, you know, four chords, but you chose four different ones than the last time, you know?
Or the reharmonization stuff too. I know that's like a heavy term for a podcast, but
I know that's what, you this
know,
is about.
Reharmonization is basically keeping the melody on top and, playing with a couple of the chord tonalities beneath.
Right.
You know, and almost like a parallel universe of chords that kind of actually still work together, but are slightly different.
Right, and that's probably what I'm thinking. That's probably what I was remembering, something like that happening.
You know, I mean, it makes me think, you know, there's a band like the Keith Jarrett Trio.
Sure.
You know, Keith Jarrett, the pianist. I mean, that's a band that really, like, bends and weaves over old standards, too. You know, they'll take a song like God Bless the Child or, you know, Autumn Leaves or something, and then they'll just take it on, you know, in the moment, you know. And we were on a plane with them once to Japan, and that's about it. It was kind of uneventful.
Oh no.
Yeah, that's, we were in a different section of the plane. That was about it. It was cool though, the two trios two trios were on, you know, on the same plane. It right. could have been a disaster. You never right. know.
But I think you're right, though. It wasn't just like, okay, the head of the tune is over. Like, now there's a raging, you know, jam bandy solo, you know, guitar solo yeah. for a million bars, and then we'll figure out when to end it. There was, like, that full band kind of, you know, in the moment song crafting
yeah.
that was happening.
Yeah, and it's funny, you know, over the album cycles, like you mentioned, sometimes True to Nothing. And yeah, that was a big song for us. I agree. But over the album cycles, we, you know, we just would like add one more instrument or one more pedal.
Right.
You know, it was kind of funny, you know.
Well, at one point you ended up with like, didn't you have like bass pedals on the floor
oh, yeah.
at one point?
Oh, yeah.
And you'd oh, like yeah. play guitar and then you just play the bass with the bass pedals?
Yep. Or tunes. Vice versa. Like I'd play bass and then play the high, high string part
uh-huh.
with right. my feet.
What were the tunes that you did that with?
A whole bunch, but it's really? It's hard to remember.
So
you know,
many. Yeah,
definitely stuff off Eisenhower, which was our last studio record.
Right.
There was definitely some like moves I had for uh-huh. for a lot of those tunes.
Right.
But you know, so it was cool. Sometimes I'd be like, oh, the sound man wasn't getting it. You know,
right.
I'd be like,
right.
damn, that was a lot of work.
Right.
You know.
It's, yeah.
And it kind of must have just looked like I was trying to kill a rat the whole show, you know,
just stomping like, on stuff. No you one know, knows
so
what it is.
It was cool.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember when I had the idea for that, and I was like, "That's a good idea. I should just do that." And you know, I was like driving across country with my girlfriend at the time.
Yeah.
And I was like, "Film me. I'm going to call Brad. Tell him about this idea."
Yeah. Well, you so, could, I so, mean, that was a thing that you guys definitely had a lot going on. Like, you'd show up to a gig with like just stuff.
You know, oh man,
you had
yeah,
stuff
so
and Brad
gear.
Had stuff like, I don't know what the hell they were, like, you know, voice recorders that you'd hold up to the pickups or something. I don't
oh,
know
yeah.
what was going on with you guys.
We had a lot of instruments too.
Yeah,
you know, oh man,
yeah.
I'd roll with like four basses, and Brad had tons of guitars, and Andrew
yeah.
had tons of gear.
Yeah, it's funny.
I still see those guys, and they're definitely, eventually I got some road cases and just like threw everything in road cases, but
yeah,
I still, you know, I see those guys and they still roll with a bunch of stuff, you know.
Oh yeah,
they're keeping it alive. It's
I
awesome.
Got to catch them. I've only gotten to see the Barr Brothers once, but I caught them in Chicago last year, and it was very cool. I mean, you
yeah
know, Brad's definitely worked really hard on the vocals and the songwriting in that vein, and I think it's paid off for him.
Yeah.
But and I saw you guys recently did a Surprise Me Mr. Davis thing.
Yeah, we did a set at the High Sierra Music Festival.
How was that?
Which is
it's been a
still
while, right?
Going strong. Yeah. That festival. Yeah. It was really fun. It was, you know, it's definitely, we used to be able to like play once a year and it felt really normal. I mean, it's been a couple of years, so it was definitely like a little bit like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I forgot about that song or that
right.
section.
Yeah.
But really, it probably was hard to tell that we hadn't played in a while. It was
yeah,
really fun.
Nobody knew but you guys, I'm sure.
Yep.
Yeah.
It was great, you know. We yeah. Sometimes we have Marco Benevento on keys sure. for that band, but he
uh-huh.
wasn't available for that fly-in.
Right.
But uh-huh. he's been with that group for the last couple of years, and he's basically a member too. Whenever we do something again, he'll be out
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
It was really fun. I sat in with the Barr Brothers on Baba O'Reilly, which is
oh,
like
nice.
A slip but, tune. We no, it's a
Who
tune, obviously,
yeah.
but we used
right.
to cover it in the slip.
Yep.
Yeah, then we did a little late night jam.
Nice.
Where we got shut down by the security. Oh. And then. and then.
The security of the festival shut you down? Isn't that the point of the festival?
Well, we were doing a rogue set. So.
Oh, gotcha. Gotcha.
Yeah.
I thought maybe Bob O'Reilly just got too out of hand. They had to shut it down.
No, it was the later stuff.
Uh-huh.
They didn't like the sensitive folk.
Oh.
That was the problem.
Oh, okay.
Too real.
Too
got sensitive.
Too real, too deep, yeah.
It got too real for a second.
Yeah.
And so, that was it. It was really short and sweet. And honestly, like in the spring, I was up recording some new songs with the slip.
Oh,
so,
really? Are you allowed to say that out loud?
I didn't say that out loud, did I?
I think you did.
No, I didn't.
Oh my goodness. That's the most exciting news
had,
I've heard all week.
Honestly, like we've had new tracks in the can, like demos, since 2009 or 10
uh-huh.
that are just, you know, filled up on, you know, hard drives and stuff. And there's, you know, maybe 20 song ideas, a bunch of demos.
Yeah.
And these were like three newer ideas.
Okay.
And so, you know, who knows what we'll do with it, but it's there. It's kind of just, you know, there is some life there, and like, there's definitely not a lot of bad blood. You know, I think we just see the band as like brothers, and
yeah,
we did do it since honestly like high school. So by the time we all hit 30, we were all a little bit like haggard emotionally, or
it's tough.
Not, you know, I've been in a lot of, I thought it might be easier to be in other bands. It really isn't. Like, then the Slip was something great, and there's some, we had a great crew and a great vibe.
Yeah.
So, who wouldn't miss that? You know, I definitely miss it a little bit, but
yeah,
we had a good thing going on.
And you guys toured like lunatics.
Yeah. Well, that was the time to do that though, too.
Oh, for sure. But you know, that's young, and it's not easy.
But we definitely wanted to see what it was like to not be a part of that for a while. And, you know, it's stretched out to about 10 years now. So
has it really been that long? Wow.
Kind of.
I mean, if you're willing to share, is there any like particular reason why you guys stopped, or, you know, any hopes for all the fans that you'll pick it back up again one day?
I think there's always, you know, like a whole wide range of, you know, different reasons that come in and out of, you know, our minds. But like, I guess it's a bit of a relaxed mystery to me, you know, like I'm not always 100% sure why, you know, why it's surprising Mr. Davis as well as the Slip, our project with Nathan,
right?
Why it's not as active to me, it's a little bit of a drag, because I'd like to perform that music for the people who enjoy it, you know. Just that simple process.
Sure. We definitely
it's not always a simple process, and I respect that too, you know.
Sure.
It's simple and complicated, I guess, or you know, whatnot. So
okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's I always you know, there's current things in the mix, and there's always a little bit of dialogue that I think pushes us towards, you know, releasing some content eventually.
But is it ever like explicit, like when you record new music, are you like, okay, now we're recording these tunes, is there then like a conversation like, why are we doing this? Or it's just like, we love each other, we love playing together, even though we're not playing together that often anymore, we still want to be making music together?
Yeah, I would say it's more like analogous to that situation, you know, like we do have, I don't know, I guess we see the fact that we don't have like physical goals of getting the music out or performing as much.
Right.
We see the process of just getting together and recording and writing new stuff as like part of, you know, something we'd like to do and keep right. active.
Nice.
You know?
Okay.
So there's ideas passed back and forth, and you know, it's just like a different kind of pace, you know.
Yeah.
It's, I'd say like Insects work at a very, very fast pace, you know, like way faster than us, and
the
you know,
Slip
every,
works at a slow pace.
The humans are on a different kind of, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we'll wait patiently, and when you are ready to tour, I will be. I mean, I'm sure you'll have agents, and they'll want to book you everywhere, but you know, save my number. I will promote shows. I will be the first one lined up, willing to risk my
That's awesome.
My savings for the benefit of other people seeing you guys perform live.
that's beautiful. Yeah.
There's actually
You know, I'd love to, you know, go wherever you send us.
Oh, great, good. I'll start mapping.
Oh, yeah.
Now. You know,
I mean, even if you you know, get us in some like matinee afternoon, you know, gigs for old timers.
Century
or whatnot.
Village.
We're into that,
yeah, sure,
you know?
Sure.
We're a little bit older, and we like to get to bed early.
Uh huh.
So.
No problem. Five p.m. You know, early bird
sure.
special shows.
Sure.
There's actually a festival. It's like the saving grace of Miami, as far as like, I mean, there's actually pretty decent live music. It's grown pretty nicely down here in the last, I'd say, 6 or 7 years. But you know, the band Snarky Puppy.
Yeah.
Yes, that guy. So they have their festival is here. Like it's less than a mile from my house where they have it. And like last year when it happened, I was thinking like, man, this would be the place that I should like call up whoever your agent was and force the Slip to get back together and play this show. It's like on the beach, it's on the water.
Oh man,
it's on like a band
show.
That'd
be awesome.
Yeah,
because you're in southern. Yeah, you're in southern Florida.
Yeah,
right?
I'm in like Miami Beach area, and it's this little old band show.
It's funny, like some of the last years of touring, when we were touring heavy, I remember going down that way like a little more. It was kind of fun.
Yeah,
you know, down to Florida and stuff. We hadn't really done that before.
Yeah,
like in the previous years.
Yeah, well, I'll call. I'll track down. Actually, the school, the school where my kids take music lessons, they're like, the guys who run that music school actually are the ones who help build out that festival. So I'm gonna go down there and talk to them and tell them they need to book a handful of Slip gigs and Bar Brother gigs for that festival and bring everyone on down.
That's awesome. Yeah, hopefully in the next couple of years or something, we'll swing on down there.
Yeah, for sure. That'd be great. I'll get working on it, I guess. But you say you haven't played for 10 years, but I mean, that's not fully true, right?
You know, we did do sporadic shows, you know, through 2012. I would say we did some like New Year's Eve stuff in San Francisco and stuff like that. But we've all had kids at this point. So we all have like kids that are very young, and we're basically teaching them the songs, you know.
they'll
we're
take
like,
it
okay,
over.
So this is cumulus.
That's right.
This is the G chord.
Right.
You're going to do this.
by the way, so cumulus was 100% like the tune that hooked me, that, you know, I had been in college for like 4 days at that point.
Yeah.
When I think I saw you guys, and I for a little while, I had a gig. I was playing. I was playing the acoustic shows with the singer Matis Yahoo. So we did like 20 to 30 shows a year, like, you know, like one-offs and like college campuses and things like that, like speaker series gigs. And, you know, then I also had some kids. I still have small kids, so it was just too much. And his main guitar player is really, really great player. So I kind of backed out, let him take over all of it. The point of me bringing that up is that there's a tune that we did, and I would play Cumulus as like the start of the improv. I'm pretty sure Matt to this day has no idea that's what I was doing every time. It was literally every time. Like the song would end in E minor, you know, and I would just go, you know, that, you know, the open G, and just start it and just kind of start, you know, playing it. And I would play like 70% of the song, you know.
Nice. But Alta used to be placing a change for bloodstains. Sun rays illuminate the smoke-filled haze. Trace of incense, the center sacrifice date. Trace of incense, the center. I said, ace time, meet eternally. A fire burns continuously. I'm wondering the way you've been. Won't you come on home to me? To me. So nice. You were playing acoustic band with Modus?
Yeah, so it was the two of us.
Did he go to St. Louis? How'd you know him?
So I met him after I graduated. So I stayed in St. Louis for almost four years after I went to graduate school at Washington University in St. Louis also. And I met him at like one of his first gigs. I was in New York. Actually, the reason I met him, this is 100% true story. The reason I met him is because of Bill Carbone.
Yeah.
I was in New York. I was still in touch with Bill, who was the drummer in the Miracle Orchestra at that time.
Sure.
For those listening, don't know. And for some reason we were in touch, and he knew I was in New York, and he got a gig playing in David Gould's band, Adonai and I. Remember that thing that David had for a while, the bass player from John Brown's Body?
Sure. Yeah, I know David. Yeah.
So he had this, like, you know, the songs you would learn in Hebrew school, but done as like serious dub tunes.
And, oh, nice.
And Bill was the drummer in that, and he knew I'd like started to get into my, I don't know, we had been, I don't even know why he knew this, but he knew I was like into, like, I was like investigating Judaism, and he was like, you'll dig this band because it's like, you know, Jewish songs.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I was in New York for whatever, for my grandfather's unveiling, actually. And he was like, come to this gig. I'm the drummer in it. You know, it should be, you'll dig it. So I went, and Matis Yahoo was like one of his first gigs. He was the opening act.
Yeah.
And so I met him and was like, okay, this is really interesting. And I was still trying to promote shows in St. Louis, so I brought him to St. Louis a few months later.
Oh, that's awesome.
And then I met him. And the full version of that story is he came in a few days earlier, and his band was going to come in on show day and there was a blizzard in New York. They didn't make it in. So I played guitar on that first gig with him. Like I just wrote out, you know, charts on the floor and, you know, played terribly.
Yeah.
But I, you know, I figured it out.
He's like, you're one hell of a promoter, dude.
Yeah, that's right.
You're like, I got this.
That's exactly right. I mean, that's literally what happened. I went to the jazz department. I was like, I need a bass player who can, like, you know, read charts, like, without any rehearsal, you know. I was like,
yeah.
And that's what we did. And then, yeah, we hit it off from there. You know, his
that's
main.
That's great.
Yeah, the guitar player he's been with since college, Aaron Dugan, who's incredible. I love his playing. So when we did the acoustic thing, I had started, like, arranging. Like, I knew my limitations as a player pretty early on, and in, like, school I found, like, my walls that I couldn't get over, so I kind of started developing, like, an acoustic style. I always had a good right hand. I started as, you know, on classical guitar. So I was like, okay, let me find my own thing with this. And then I kind of did these acoustic arrangements for him, and that's how he started using me for those gigs. And that lasted, like, 4 or 5 years. And then I kind of...
You were doing his acoustic work?
Yeah, so we
oh,
did...
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so he would do, we did a tour of it also, but I mean, most of it was like one-off stuff. It was like, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was cool.
That's awesome.
But anyway, so I used to show.
I love the cats who play bass and drums with them. Those are
yes,
friends of mine.
Yes.
Joe and Stu.
They're amazing. Yeah.
Awesome dudes.
Yeah, they're so good. That's one of the best rhythm sections.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so anyway, so I used to shove, that's a long way of saying I shove Cumulus into his set without him knowing many times.
That's awesome.
He would just be beatboxing on top of it and just think I was improvising. So anyways, one of the other things that I mentioned it earlier, but there's a funny thing is that like my main like source of exercise is I've been swimming a lot and I got these underwater headphones and,
oh, cool.
Yeah. And so you can put music on them, but they immediately kind of broke and I can't add any new music to them. So I'm kind of been stuck for like a year with what I put on them a year ago. And there's three tunes. There's a bunch of stuff on there, but there's three slip tunes I put on there. One was Driving Backwards with You,
oh, cool.
I think it's called, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes True to Nothing and Nelly Jean. And
oh,
all
cool.
three of those tunes have like that, to me, like the brilliant classic Mark thing, which is like you take like the main voice over at some point in the tune. Like, you know, not necessarily the melody,
yeah.
but you become... whether it's a solo, whether it is the melody, or whether it's, you know, something that's going against, you know, the vocal melody that just happened. And I love that. And there's not a lot of bands who do that. And to me, you're like the quintessential player who like does that in a pop or rock context, right? It's not, it's
yeah.
not like you're taking a solo. You're saying something melodically that's very distinct. Is that...
Oh, it's very cool.
Yeah, like where is that something you just started again because of the trio format? You're like, we have to cover different parts, or is it, you know, something you've worked on?
Well, I think the way I was approaching 4-string like fretless bass early
yeah.
on was very melodic. And what I was, so you know, all of us taking as many solos as we wanted,
yeah,
was always a big part of the band,
yeah,
and was encouraged. So there was that, and then at home I was always practicing, and I still am, but at, you know, at that time jazz improvisation and improvisational techniques were like really what I was into, and that fell in the upper register of the bass a lot.
Sure.
So there was a lot of comfort there, and you know, it's kind of like a cello when you get in that area.
Sure.
And so it's kind of a mid-range melody, and yeah, it just kind of worked. We like to incorporate little sections in the tunes that were not always solos, but like you said, had like, you know, different instruments would take the melody, and a lot of times that would be the bass or whatnot, you know.
Yeah.
And I think Brad really liked it. Probably gave him a chance to like not be singing and like, you know,
yeah.
work on some comping and some background effects and
right.
stuff, and. Yeah, it just kind of worked for the music. You know, I had the same experience too. I think I was listening to Angels Come on Time and
yeah.
Does, like those two middle records.
Yeah.
I was checking those out a couple of years ago, and it was really fun. It's very entertaining to hear how we approach that stuff with just a couple overdubs here and there
yeah.
on that music. And then you can really hear our own voices come through our instruments. Yeah.
yeah.
Take a lot of risks and stuff.
Yeah.
It's cool. It is like it's a certain style of music that is, you know, it kind of stands on its own.
Right.
I don't really know. It is songwriting and improvisation and also like melodic arrangements. And all that stuff was good and bad for us. It was great for our audience, you know.
Yeah.
Like we had these fans in St. Louis that were just awesome, you know, and a couple other spots.
Yeah.
But it was also really hard for like press agents and
yeah.
Some, you know, it was really hard for some people to digest us, and also people had way overly anxiety about how to present us, and they really didn't have to. Like it was just like a band, you know. Right. And usually, yeah, I could tell by the bouncers and the bartenders that they were like, "Oh, this isn't so weird. It's just kind of like music."
Yeah.
Like, and there's three guys playing it, and it's kind of improv-y, and it's got a little bit of
right
different stuff, you know.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, yeah, like that was kind of our thing. It was kind of a hard sell, but like we did end up working with some people that were really good at elaborating at what we did.
Yeah.
And a lot of publications and stuff did give us like really good press, and yeah, actually did their homework and dug deep into the songs and were like, "Oh,
yeah,
this is interesting," you know.
Yeah.
So we were lucky. It's cool.
And you still do like improvisational kind of workouts? You still have exercises and stuff that you do on a regular basis?
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
What are the secret weapons that Mark uses?
Oh, the secret weapons? What's hot right now?
Yeah.
I still teach a little, which is cool. I'll teach like high school students in Providence.
Nice. Uh-huh.
And which is really fun because I like getting kids started,
yeah,
on like learning stuff. And I have some students like my age. I mean, in the last couple of years, I've been really I've always really liked the audio engineering angle, so I've been doing that a lot with my time, but also playing the acoustic bass more, which, uh-huh, is really fun.
Yeah.
I tried to play it in the early days of the slip, but it was just like, it didn't fit in the van, and I was
right,
like, I think I weighed 115 pounds.
Yeah, and the bass weighed 120.
Yeah, I didn't have the strength to really like dig in, and now it's been easier the last couple of years. I have the discipline. I don't need to like play fast Donna Lee stuff to,
right,
you know, to make myself like happy, you know.
Yeah.
And I've just had the time to really get into it and even work on the bow.
Oh,
so when I play upright, I'm working on some of my older improv stuff, you know, like,
yeah,
chromatic scales and, arpeggio inversions and stuff,
uh-huh,
you know, and different, sure, patterns for that.
Yeah.
And so I kind of, it's fun to kind of apply a retro improv thing to my upright. And then with electric and stuff, I'm always working on independence a little bit, but I have a pretty traditional like two finger approach.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say things I'm working on is really like multi time things.
Okay.
Like hearing five against four.
Sure.
Or like trying to make five feel like rock and roll.
Okay. Yeah.
You know, like when it's placed over four, things that can get superimposed over each other.
Sure.
Kind of like a quantum universe of music.
Right. So you're saying if you were the guitar player on Pink Floyd's Money, you would have taken the guitar solo in five. You wouldn't have switched it back to four.
Something like that. So like I'm really into time thing, just like going through from the number three all the way to like 9, 11, 12, 15,
uh-huh,
trying to figure out how those all fit into like groups of four and eight.
Right. And yeah,
so I do that a lot.
Oh,
for like
interesting
time stuff. And then I'm really interested on like, you ever heard of a book called Slominsky?
No.
It's like a European book about, and it's kind of just got every kind of like combination of notes in a pattern,
okay,
that you could think of.
Okay.
And so I'm really into art and stuff like that too. So a lot of the things I work on are just like, what is the craziest pattern that makes sense? Not even harmonic sense, but just ideas I would have never thought of, like stacking a major like a major third and then a whole step,
mm-hmm,
and then a minor third. This is like hardcore music stuff, but
yeah,
weird.
That's good.
Like just weird scales I would have never thought of, and close harmonic figures,
uh-huh,
that I start to just bend my ear into understanding what they mean.
Okay.
And it's kind of like stuff like Coltrane would kind of shed, the Slominsky book, because it's just like really crazy chromatic scale, like chromatic ideas.
Uh-huh.
And it's it's fun.
Cool.
I use like notation paper a lot, so I don't forget what I'm doing.
Wow.
and I'm just writing out like little ideas that I've never thought of before.
That's cool.
And usually always like work, trying to work with a metronome so I can keep it in time or whatever.
Right.
And also like taking an ostinato rhythmic feel and trying to move it in different places over the beat. So, you know, just kind of shifting things around a lot.
Yeah.
Just kind of, you know, I don't know. Just weird chemistry experiments.
Right. Oh, that's great. I mean, you get to, in and around Boston, do you get to play in a more jazz context and kind of, you know, strut your stuff in that regard? Or
it goes back and forth. I mean, definitely here and there. There's definitely, what I've been doing in Boston is more reggae and hip-hop influenced these days.
Yeah.
Which has been really fun. The reggae stuff is, there's a good scene for it in Boston. So there's a lot of like ska, early Jamaican root stuff, Jamaican jazz.
Yeah.
And that stuff is like really kicking my butt actually, because it's like I thought I could play reggae really well or whatever, you know, or had some approach to it. And it's just an education, because like trying to remembering and playing the bass lines correctly is kind of like bebop in a way. And it's really fun.
Yeah.
It's a super challenge.
Yeah, I do a gig. It's
yeah. Yeah, and harmonically, because it falls on all different sorts of parts, ends of the clave, and it's really cool.
Right.
I played some calypso music like 20 years ago or 15 years ago with a guy, and that kind of led me into the reggae thing, where they're all kind of they're related in a certain way, and it's a really fun language, and I'm loving it. You know,
yeah, that's cool.
Anything, all the. There's Bob Marley, which is incredible, but all the other musicians from Jamaica are just incredible. I can't find one I don't like. I mean, honestly.
What's a particular Jamaican artist that you're into right now that people may not know about? I mean,
there's cats like Dennis Brown.
Okay.
Let's see. I mean, there's Scottolites, obviously.
Sure. Yeah.
I'd have to. You know, it's all kind of new to me, so I'd have to look at my list. The older cats are, I'd have to look at some of my playlists, but...
Yeah. The other day, I was, like, I had in, like, a live Bob Marley record, and I think it was, like, Rebel Music. And, like, in my head, I was just singing the bass line, and then I realized I was singing on the wrong parts of the, you know, the beat. And then you listen to it, you're like, wow, like, that pocket is so... It's so deep, but it's so interesting. It's just not obvious if you, like, come from a rock background where...
Yeah.
They accent everything. And then I was like
working
really hard in the car while driving, like, okay, let me pay attention and, you know, let me count it out. And okay, that's where, you know, that's where these accents are coming. It is really
Oh yeah. And a lot of times on the fourth bar, they'll do something different or something.
Yeah.
And you're like, and that's just as important too, you know?
Yeah.
It's really cool.
Cool.
I kind of treat it like I relate it to more like bebop. Like, all right, this is like really intricate, like, rhythmic and melodic stuff going on here,
right?
And you got to treat it right. You know.
So cool. Look, Mark, thanks. Unless there's anything else you want to talk about, this was great. I really appreciate it. The last thing I'll say, because I can't find the recording anywhere, and there was a concerted effort to find it maybe a couple years ago with the St. Louis crew, but there was a Slip gig years ago, and there's at least a half a dozen people who will attest to it, but you guys were improvising something. It was at Cicero's, and there was like that moment, you know, you referenced before, like you would just look at Brad and Andrew and everybody kind of knew, and something happened and you played this like quick flurry of notes and just landed on something that everyone kind of stopped. Brad and Andrew stopped with you, and I remember after that gig we all said that was the best note anybody's ever played. And we can't find the recording. I found the year, I think, after it. I found it on E-Tree, but I can't find that one. But that's going to be one of my missions. I need to track it down.
One of my missions.
I got to get all the Cicero shows that Slip played and find one of the best notes ever played.
I really appreciate that, the sentiment though. And that's really nice.
Yeah, it was just the level of
musicianship. You guys were always, you guys inspired us. You know, you guys were a really great like pocket of support for us in the Midwest and
yeah,
in the country, you know. You guys made it a lot of fun.
That's cool.
You know, what we did.
We tried. I mean, we were way into what you guys were doing musically, and not just in the context of the Slip, just as players. You guys were, for guys who are all, you know, 2 to 4 years younger than you guys, it was something to look up to and say, okay, you know, look how unique and inventive and creative and inspiring, you know, a bunch of guys, you know, 2 to 4 years older than us can be. So we can try.
That's
too.
That's awesome.
You know?
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, the feeling was mutual. We needed you guys to like keep us going and let us know we were on the right track or whatnot.
Yeah.
So,
all right, cool.
Yeah. Thanks for doing this. I don't do a lot of interviews.
Well, my pleasure. And it was
totally
nice
by
catching
choice
up.
Too.
Thanks.
Yeah, man. I'll try to send you some of that Freedom Trail stuff.
Yeah, please do.
Too. So just keep in touch.
I will.
Have a great time out there. Do you have a family out in Miami?
I do. We have 3 kids.
Whoa.
And yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And how many are you working on?
I have a little boy named Oliver who's like a little over a year.
Cool.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Yeah, we have a 4-year-old, an 8-year-old, and a 10-year-old. And it's all kinds
nice.
It's all kinds of craziness, but it's great.
Those are the good years.
They are.
All yeah. Even numbers. It's great.
I never thought about it that way. all right, man. I really appreciate it. Thanks. And I'll hit you up before this goes up. And so let's stay in touch, and I'll keep paying attention to your music. It's awesome.
Okay, I appreciate that, Adam. Good to talk to you.
You too. Thanks, Mark.
Take care.
All right, there you have it, the great Marc Friedman. It was a real joy and honor to get to chat with Mark. He really is one of my favorite bass players of all time. So I hope you all enjoyed that. We'll be back in a week or two with the great and knowledgeable Emily. And until then, here it is, royalty free, the track Walk the Line by Marc Friedman at Freedom Trail Studios and the YouTube Creator Studios. Bye-bye.